dear students, welcome to this edition of VBS Anatoma, a series of e-learning gross anatomy videos posted on YouTube. I am sure this will be of use for medical, dental, physiotherapy, nursing, and paramedical, medical allied courses, allied health courses. Today's topic is sphenoid sinus. I'm Dr. Balasubramanyam, work here as professor in the Department of Anatomy, St. John's Medical College, Bangalore. Now, this is an horizontal section of the dry skull, roughly through the upper nose. You can see the ethmoid and the sphenoid sinus. Let's put up the labels to identify them. That's the ethmoid sinus, and behind that is the sphenoidal sinus. For reference, here also this is a nasal septum. This is only for identification purposes. Now, that's the orbit on either sides of the ethmoid sinus. That gives you a rough relation to the sphenoid. In other words, the apex of the orbit is closely related to the sphenoid bone. Now, we will zoom in on the horizontal section. Only thing is the orientation is different from the previous slide. Now, we are looking at the sphenoid ear sinus from above, and first thing we are, let's identify the pituitary fossa. Right in front of it is the sphenoidal sinus. Further in on either sides, you can see anteriorly and laterally the rather superiorly the frontal bone, orbital plate of the frontal bone. That's the orbital cavity, external nose. So this gives you a rough orientation of all the sinuses in between the nasal cavity and the orbital cavity, particularly the ethmoid and its posterior relation, the sphenoidal sinus. Next, again back to the sphenoid sinus, posterior ethmoid sinus. Same, as I told you, let's check it out on an imaging modality. This is the sphenoid sinus with septum, posterior ethmoidal sinus, optic canal with the optic nerve. This is important, optic canal and the optic nerve, how closely it's related to the sphenoid sinus. Now here, more lateral to the sinus, internal carotid artery entering the cavernous sinus. That's why you are seeing it in cross section. Now that's the middle cranial fossa and its content, basically the temporal bone, very specifically at this area of discussion. Now here is a dry skull sagittal section. Let's get the orientation of the sphenoid sinus clearly. Now that's the sphenoid sinus. You can notice right above is the middle cranial fossa. Immediately below is the pterygopalatine fossa, posteriorly the clivus. Let's see, right in front, anterolateral I would say, is the posterior ethmoidal sinus, sphenopalatine foramen as I mentioned, above the middle cranial fossa. Now again, another dry skull superior sinus. You can see that a part of it is going into the posteriorly to an area below the clivus. This kind of pneumatization is quite possible. It's quite a common variable. Now, right in front of the sphenoidal ear sinus is this superior meatus, an important reference for the entry through the anterior wall of the sphenoidal sinus. Now, that's the sphenoethmoidal recess immediately above the superior meatus, superior concha, I repeat, meatus, then the concha, and then above it the sphenoethmoidal recess. Now, this is a wet specimen. You can see the pituitary gland and the pituitary fossa around it. The yellow arrow is the sphenoethmoidal recess. You can see the sphenoid opening into that recess. There is a small cavity right in front of that dotted circle. In fact, between the red-white dotted circle and the arrow, that possibly may be a protruding posterior ethmoidal sinus. That has a specific name and has a clinical importance. We will rediscuss it at a later stage. Now, repeat, pituitary fossa with a gland. Now, superior concha is shown. Earlier I had shown the meatus. Now, right above the superior sphenoidal sinus is the middle cranial fossa and its contents. Now, here is a coronal section, once again head region. It is passing roughly through the optic chiasma. You can see the right behind the optic chiasma is the pituitary stalk. The optic chiasma is now labeled. Then pituitary gland and the fossa are right in the middle. You can see the lower end of the pituitary stalk almost reaching the pituitary fossa at the pituitary gland. Now, on either sides of the sphenoid sinus is the cavernous sinus and its contents, namely the internal carotid artery. More on the lateral side are the cranial nerves going towards the orbital cavity, the third, the fourth, the fifth, and the sixth cranial nerves. Now, again, this is an MRI coronal section. Whatever you saw previously, let's re-identify on an imaging specimen like this. Now, you see, I have blown up that area, expanded it. Sphenoidal sinus, let's first identify. Right above it, the pituitary fossa and the pituitary stalk. I repeat, pituitary fossa with the gland. Then, more laterally, the cavernous sinus and its contents, mainly the internal carotid, third, fourth, and the fifth cranial nerves, particularly along the lateral wall. Optic tract. Uncus is much more lateral to the cavernous sinus, but nevertheless an important relation to the sphenoidal sinus. Nasopharynx right below the sphenoidal sinus. That gives you a complete picture of the strategic location, central location of the sphenoidal sinus and how many structures are related to it. Next, superior view, that is view from the floor of the cranial cavity. This is a wet specimen. You can see along the posterior part of the pituitary fossa, the sella tarsica and its slope posteriorly, the clivus, which virtually forms the posterior wall of the sphenoidal sinus. Laterally, the cavernous sinus and its contents, I repeated this earlier. Optic anteriorly and laterally, the optic nerve in the optic canal. And a little bit of the jugum sphenoidal immediately anterior. Now, a few clinical points to help us understand why this sinus is so important, it may be worth considering. Other than what I have mentioned in the previous classes on the sinuses, infections, allergies, and trauma are three principal causes around which these symptoms of sphenoidal air sinus involvement can be seen. While the basic principles remain the same, one or two additional points may be worthy of mention at this stage. Now you see, there is an important cell called the ONOD cell. This is nothing but, as I mentioned this in one of the previous slides of this video, it is a posterior ethmoidal cell that overlies superior and lateral to the sphenoidal sinus. See, the sphenoidal sinus is here and right above, you can see there is a partition there and right above is the ONOD cell. Now, this cell is important, although it is a variant, it is important because many times during endoscopic approach to reach the sphenoidal sinus, it's likely that instead of the sphenoidal sinus, the tip of the endoscope may actually go into the sinus, giving you a false sense of direction. In fact, by doing it, we may actually end up in the damage to the orbital apex, particularly the optic nerve. Now that's a very important precaution you have to take. You have to better before any endoscopic procedure is taken. An X-ray is taken or a CT or an MRI to make sure if the O-node D cell is there, in which case appropriate corrective steps can be taken well in advance. Now, although there are several other approaches, these two approaches I am mentioning for the sake of surgical importance. One is the transfrontal or the transcribriform approach, where you go through the frontal bone, chop up the cribriform plate a little bit, and then go down to reach the sphenoidal sinus. Remember, there is a great risk of damage to the meninges, but then this is one of the possible approaches. But more commonly, the transnasal approach is worthy of a note. You can go through the nose, through the nasal cavity, go to the level of the superior concha, and then directly tap into the anterior wall of the sphenoidal sinus, and there you are there. From the sphenoidal sinus, you can go up to operate on pituitary tumors also. Therefore, this is one of the good approaches, particularly after the advent of endoscopic surgery. That's the sphenoidal sinus. Pituitary gland, as I mentioned. This slide has been discussed in anatomical detail earlier. I told you these are the three causes of sphenoidal sinus problems, clinical problems. It is invariably associated with rhinosinusitis. As long as the drainage into the sphenoethmoidal recess is okay, there is a way out for all the secretions, it's fine. But if there is a blockade, then we may have to treat the condition more aggressively. Again, being in a strategic location, infections here could involve the middle cranial fossa or the anterior cranial fossa. There could be meningeal involvement, and also further damage. There may be CSF rhinorrhea because the arachnoid has been touched and we have entered the arachnoid, subarachnoid space. More importantly, anteriorly, we mentioned its closeness to the optic nerve and the optic canal, and therefore the orbital involvement could be quite a bad complication. Now, that was an overview of the surgical anatomy of the sphenoid sinus. I hope you have benefited from this lecture. If there are any questions, you can send me to this email ID, or better still, there is a blog area immediately, text blog immediately below the YouTube video. You can post it there so that I can have a look and give you an opinion. With those words, I would like to say thank you for your patient hearing.